That is why they call me the postman. So like I said, here we are in Pelsall at Rocket Pool. I am the postman. I think I went a bit cross-eyed because I was looking at my rods. I was like, I've just seen a car.
Hey, boss.
I'm all disorientated because of that light.
Oh, please be big and fat and scaly.
Oh, well, it really is a fresh one this morning, and you join me at Clearwater Fisheries in Carnforth. Now, yesterday we got down here and we were greeted by all the lakes being frozen, but we knew the forecast was due to change. We had a little bit of product filming to do in the meantime, so during the course of the day we got that polished off, and as luck would have it, a couple of swims defrosted on Kellett. We decided to chuck the rods out a little bit early. Now, we're here to do a little in-session piece all about winter carp fishing, the baits and some tactics that I employ when the water's at its coldest. Up and down the country, all the lakes we've seen on social media, they're all froze up. Just as they start to defrost, there's a little opportunity there if you get your tactics right. So, as I say, we got the rods out last night, put a little bit of bait out, but I was far from expecting to have a bite, if I'm honest. It really was bleak, but half past nine, middle rod pulled up, and had a lovely fish. So, what I'm gonna do now, while this mist starts to clear, I'm gonna get some breakfast on, get another brew on, and while I do that, here's that fish from last night. Well then, how's about that? We're so far up north, we might as well be in Scotland. It's certainly as far north as I've ever carp fished. The lake was probably 80% froze over this morning. And put a little bit of bait out just before dark. Just on the phone to me, mate, and the middle rod's absolutely busted off. So, proof in the pudding, those tactics, those naturals and that bit of boily. Got those fish down there looking for a bit of food. And despite it being absolutely freezing, we're into a carp. So yeah, really couldn't ask for more. And hopefully there's a couple more to come. Oh, a nice scaly one. Come on, girl. Hey, I'll have a bit of that. That is why they call me the postman. Well, there we have it. Lovely 20 pound clear water mirror. There's loads of lovely fish like this in Kellett Lake. And as the name suggests, clear water, the water's so tap clear. Despite how cold it's been amazing to watch a few fish scooting around the edges. And yeah, that little baited trap with them naturals and a bit of boily crumb has come up trump. So, fingers crossed, there'll be a couple more to come, but that is one hell of a start. Well then, how's about that? Literally just finished my breakfast. Me and Adam have had a couple of sausage baps. And with this mist, we were both just saying it's typically quite naff conditions. And that it was looking like it was in for the morning, and out of the blue, middle rod again, out towards the reed bed. Go into that a little bit more in detail later, but I just plumbed up just where it comes down the shelf into about 5 or 6 foot of water. And yeah, same rod again. Got another clear water fish on, so fingers crossed she stays on. I'll have another lovely scaly one to show you. I am the postman. So when it comes to fishing in the winter, when the water's at its coldest, the most second important thing to location is without doubt your bait. The water's often only 3, 4, 5 degrees above freezing, and as daft as it might sound, 5 degrees lower and it would actually be a solid block of ice. So being cold-blooded, the carp are really going to feel it, and it's going to really subdue them and slow them down. So your bait really needs to pack a punch to get them to drop down and feed when a lot of the time they don't really want to. So I think a big misconception with fishing in the winter is you need loads of naturals, it could be really expensive. And if I'm honest, that couldn't be further from the truth. I use an awful lot of naturals, but I also use some proper bait in with it that gives the fish a little bit something back and ultimately helps to get them feeding. So first and foremost, dead simple, hemp and corn. The hemp's nice and oily and that corn's really digestible with a bit of a visual aspect. And that's always in my mix in the winter. So it's worth noting, when I knock up a mix, I only knock up enough for each time I bait up. I'm putting naturals in there and they will significantly deteriorate if you leave them. So I'll knock a little mix up and I'll make sure I spot it out within half an hour of making it. So first of all, just a couple of little palmfuls of the hemp and corn. As I say, I don't want to go mad with that. So after the hemp and corn, I like to add some casters. Now, these offer a real crunch value. And for me, they're probably the most natural bait you could use. Yes, maggots and things like that imitate bloodworm, but for me, the casters imitate caddis and other insects they're going to be eating. And at all times of the year, the carp will be feasting on those. So again, I've only got a little pint here. You don't need loads. So another couple of palmfuls of casters. Say, it's quite surprising how far you can make a couple of pints of maggots and casters go. So equal measures of casters in there. Next up, I've got some boilie crumb. Now, fish up and down the country are eating boilie all year round. It gives those fish a little bit something back. This is also great for soaking any liquids and juices and what have you from the natural. So again, equal measures of that. This is the switch from DNA. It's nice and spicy and it's a fantastic all year round bait. Next up, just to complement that crumb, a little bit of the liquid food. I don't want to go mad with this because I still want the flavours of the naturals to come through, but just want to dampen that corn down a little bit, like so. Next up, we've got the old worm. Now, as I've said before, carp hangers up and down the country are using these, and they are such an effective bait. I use them an awful lot myself, and in the winter, they really can scratch you a bite when you'd otherwise struggle. So I'll have a little dig in there, and you'll find there's a little ball of them. You don't need loads, a couple of handfuls, like so. Now, that's a half a kilo bag, and I'll be honest, I can make that last a 48-hour session, providing I don't catch loads and loads. That'll get me plenty of bites, do me some hook baits too. I mean, I could just add a little bit of chop worm into my mix. So I put that inside a little bait tub. You see, I ain't got loads and loads in there, but that's more than enough to really add an extra element into your mix. So I'll chop those up like so. That's really important to let those amino acids out, which is what the fish ultimately go crazy for. So I'll chop them up nice and small, like so. You can see all the blood and the guts starting to come out of them, and that's what really does turn the fish wild. And no winter mix would be complete without some maggots. I'll be honest, the colour doesn't really bother me too much, but in this case, I've got a load of red maggots. Now, I have added some extra krill meal and liver powder onto those. I just like the fact they've got a little bit more pulling power and they're a little bit different to the maggots everyone else will be feeding. As brilliant as maggots are visually, I think they do lack a little bit in terms of smell, so obviously this mix really does complement them and helps the fish find them, and once they find them, they go absolutely crazy for them. So I'll put another couple handfuls of maggots in there, and then I'll give that a nice good stir up. Now, what I've got there is probably a mix that probably equates to probably 6 spawnfuls. I mean, on this session I'm fishing 2 different spots. I've got 2 rods on one and a rod a little bit shorter on its own, so I'm going to put 2 spods over each rod, so that's 6 spods in total. And I'm fairly confident that'll be perfect to get me another bite out there, fingers crossed. There we have it, the second fish. Great start so far, fingers crossed there's a couple more to come. Proof in the pudding, that baiting, finding the right spot and getting some rigs nice and accurate on it will catch a carp even in the coldest of conditions. So we'll slip this one back and hopefully one of his bigger brothers or sisters will pay us a visit. Cool, you can see why it's called Clearwater. Right, so we've just slipped that lovely fish back, put 4 spots back out on the area, and I've just got a rig ready to get back out there. So before I chuck it out, just show you exactly what I'm doing. Now, if you've watched any of the Avid videos, you'll be no stranger to see just how fond I am of this D-rig. But first of all, when it comes to the leader setup, I set this up on one of our ready tied heli trod leaders. Now, for me, it's super important when fishing with naturals that I've got the lead set up like this. I see lots of guys using inlines and lead clips, but for me, if you've got a hook bait on the end that any nuisance fish might want to eat, the ability to pull that bead away from the lead a little bit, A, it really helps with your presentation, and B, if any nuisance fish are pulling at those worms or maggots, they're pulling directly on the line and not against the lead. So if you do that and fish with a semi-tight line, you'll get some indication on your bobbin, you'll know exactly what's happening at the rig end, and you'll know if your worms or your maggots have been pecked off. Now, that's got 3 ounce pair lead on there. I'm not chucking out overly far, but I still want a decent size lead. The fish aren't moving very fast, the water's really cold, and that just helps the rig and the hook point drive home in the fish's mouth. Now, the rig itself is a D rig of probably 7.5-8 inches long. Got a loop on there where I can quick change it onto the leader nice and easy. I can have loads of these ready, so if I catch fish in the dark or when it's cold, I'm not fumbling around, I can be nice and organised. Got a medium sinker in the middle there, that just helps the hook link boom away when it lands on the lake bed, and if any nuisance fish do pick up that hook bait, particularly with the worms when they're pecking away at them, the rig will settle nicely on the lake bed. Hook wise, got my tried and trusted size 4 Armrock trod up there. It's a nice big strong hook, and how balanced the hook bait means I can get away with that nice big hook. Now that's got a 10 turn knotless knot, and then I turn that back over through the eye with a micro ring swivel, and that just makes a nice little D-rig setup. There's no chance the hook bait can impede the hook point with that. It doesn't tangle and I get a nice little bit of separation. Now, the real magic happens with the hook bait, and that's mounted on a micro ring swivel, as I've said. I've got a bait band looped through the final barrel there. I've set on a little pop-up in this instance, and I've got some worms pushed through the bait band. Now, on this session and on a lot of sessions when I'm fishing with naturals, with the mix I've showed you, I like to alternate with hook baits. I started this session with a couple of rigs on maggots and one on worms. The worm rod went off the spot, so I knew straight away that that was probably the hook bait to kind of persevere with, if you like. So I've changed them all over onto worms now, and I've had another bite on the worm. So really does pay to mess around with which hook baits you've got. I might well put a maggot hook bait on later in the session, but for now I'll be sticking with the worms. So I get this fired out there onto that spot at 11 rod lengths. Get the stove on because it really is cold, and hopefully another carp will pay us a visit. Well, one thing's for sure, there won't be any mice or rats in my bivvy tonight. Just gone for a little nosy round. Adam, the cameraman's minded the rods, and this little cheeky chappy was hiding under my bed chair. When it comes to fishing in the winter, your venue choice is super important. You want to be travelling to a venue that you know has got good winter form with a good stock of carp. Now, sessions like this are a case in point of that. When we got it, it was frozen. If the lake had got no winter form, we really would have absolutely no hope of getting a bite. But as it happens, the fish are more than obliging, even in the coldest of water. So, Clearwater on Kellett Lake, and as I say, it's the perfect place to come and get a bite when the water's super, super cold. Now, it comes to swim choice. We spoke to Mikey, the fishery manager, and Paul, the bailiff, and these are the guys that you need to be talking to and tapping into to get the best information possible. So, having spoke to the guys, they did say the fish are really mobile, but they told me there's some nice deep water out in front of swims 1 and 2, and I thought that was a good place to start. Now, in the winter, I think there's a big misconception that it's all about the deep water and that's where the fish live. That's really couldn't be further from the truth. They're always going to like to frequent those deeper areas, as it's a more stable temperature, but they do like exploring those shallows, and when they get moving, when they're exploring those shallows, I found they're a lot more catchable because they're moving about a little bit. So swim one is the swim I chose. I saw a little gang of fish in the really shallow water to my left, and that was all I needed to see really. They look quite mobile, they're moving around nice and fast, so experience tells me that they're fish that are well up for a little bit of food. So I was told the far side tends to do a number of the bites, so I had a little plum out there, and in line with the reed bed at 11 rod lengths, around a really nice glassy gravelly spot, and it was more than big enough to get 2 rods on. So put a little bit of bait out there, and then on my right hand rod I did fish a rod out in the deeper water. I have done fished in the deeper water, should I say, and that's just on the off chance. I've seen a number of fish show there, 10 foot. It's not a scarily deep part, so if I'm honest, I'm quietly confident I might scratch a bite from there. But if not, if the session's anything to go by, I've already had 2 bites over the far side by the reeds. I'm quietly confident I might sneak another bite. So there's another point that's well worth noting. when it comes to the information regarding the lake. Clearwater does actually have a little topography map, which is really handy. Having a little scan on that, I was able to identify areas of the lake where I thought I could kind of write off. But that said, the guys have said the fish have been getting caught right up down the shallow end in maybe 2-3 foot of water. So like all times of the year, keep your eyes open. In the winter, a lot of the time the lakes are as clear as they're ever gonna be. And this venue's super, super clear. So it's great for watching the fish. If you keep your eyes peeled, you might well find them for yourself. Well, the fog's looming again this evening. It's dropping really cold. Nothing else to report since I put that little bit of bait out, have you? But if I'm honest, if any, last night was anything to go by, I'm quietly confident. Top tip, when you order Indian the night before, make sure you add on an extra naan bread. You can thank me later for that one. Right then, so got up this morning. We had that ominous fog again, I'll be honest. It really didn't look good for a bite, but it has cleared a little bit, probably more so than any other time during the session. And same time as yesterday, middle rod again. Just on that shelf on the gravel out by the reeds. We've had a nice steady take, so we're into another fish and most likely our last one of the session. Trick for the postman. Well then, how's about that for a lovely scaly from Clearwater Kellett Lake. As I say, when I arrived here and I saw all the ice, I feared the worst. But yeah, we've had a little result and had three lovely carp. So I'm gonna slip this one back, get the gear wrapped up and head on south to Shropshire. Right, so that's the car loaded, and it's been a fantastic little trip. Despite the freezing conditions, I'll be honest, when I was heading this far up north, I really did think it was gonna be a difficult one. To get three lovely fish, it's been a right result. I really can't urge you strongly enough to come and give Clearwater Fisheries a visit. As I say, the rain's moved in now, so we've quickly packed up, and it's time to get off home. So if you've liked this video, make sure you like and subscribe to the YouTube channel to see more of the latest Avid videos.